Good evening. My name is Moises Ortiz. I'm the proud principal of Lanier High School, and it is my absolute pleasure to welcome you this evening. But first of all, I ask you to join me in rising for the Royal Guardian Color Guard for the presentation of colors under the leadership of Lieutenant Colonel Santiago Bueno and Army Instructor First Sergeant Robert Bruce. And now, in keeping with our humble welcome to you, our guests, colleagues, family, and friends, a little further token of our appreciation as we just share a little bit more of the bold blue way of doing things here at Lanier High School. Ladies, please.
Stick lights off, you sip like coffee, wake up, change your mind and drop me love. To hate me crazy, shady, spin me all like hot wasabi love. To hate me, praise me, shame me, either way you talk about me. I love the way you talk about me. Look at how far I got me. The baby's right about me. I put it up, I got about me. Like she wearing no clothes. When she going so low, I bet they're gonna break up.
Thank you.
just a little bit of that blue, bold way of doing things. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to officially welcome you to the 4th Annual State of the Union to our school's community directly from the mouth and heart of our Chief Leader Superintendent of Schools, Mr. Pedro Martinez. But before we begin, I'd like to introduce some very special guests here with us this evening. President of the Board of Directors and representative of our own Barry District 1, Ms. Patty Radel. If I could also have our associate and assistant superintendents please stand and be acknowledged for attending, Ms. Yesenia Cordova and the rest of you. Something that makes me very proud, every single one of our feeder pattern principals is here in attendance in support of the Lanier community. Please stand and be recognized. I want to begin this evening by asking Mr. Martinez, our superintendent, to remember back to June of 2019, when I had the distinct honor of being presented to the Lanier community by him and questioned by the Lanier community about what was going to happen. And in closing, Mr. Martinez, I made two promises. The first was within 1 year, we would become one of the highest performing, academically performing comprehensive high schools in the San Antonio Independent School District. And the second one, and he looked at me like, I don't know about that. We would have a winning football team. And we would have a winning record. And I guess it's because we're in Texas, guess which got the loudest applause? And it was that. So, and if you'll recall, so let's start with the hardest promise to keep. Mr. Rios, if you please will.
This year has been different in so many ways, but the game has never changed. We spent countless hours in the weight room, getting in shape and working hard.
And now.
It's time to go to work. Let's go. Are you with us? This year has been different in so many ways, but the game has never changed.
I think we're going to hear it again. Mr. Martinez, if you would be so kind as to join us at this table here. Gentlemen, are you ready? Come on out. I'd like to present you with our football district championship trophy by Captain Fabian Macias. But don't leave, sir. How about a district champion trophy and bi-district championship trophy for our boys soccer team presented by our team captains? And while we're having fun, what about a bi-district championship in basketball presented by team captains Justin Centeno and Justin Rodriguez? And last but not least, let's not forget our ladies basketball bi-district championship trophy presented by captains Jessica Garza and team. Oh yeah, they're sophomores and juniors, sir. We're just getting started. Thank you, Mr. Martinez. Thank you. But that's not all, folks. There are so many victories and so many successes that we've experienced so far. These are just four of the major successes that we've experienced as a testimonial to folks, never, and I repeat, never say die and it's alive and well in Vogue Nation. So promise two, 1 year later plus, I can now unabashedly tell you that while we did not get to test last year, and this year is simply for benchmark setting purposes, based on the fact that our December of 2009 middle of the year scores already showed over 70% had made yearly academic progress, we were on a road to success. And then we've had a little bit of a setback, but we never say die. So while I made you two promises, and they were kind of general back then, you know, we'll be at the top performing, you know, we're gonna make it. Now I have, and I'm gonna unabashedly tell you, I have four of the strongest academics in the district, if not the city and the state. And you have my full attestation that by the end of next school year, we will once we get back to the normal of the new school format, Lanier will come in at the top two slots in at least three of the five tested areas. And I'm looking at the principal, former principal of Brackenridge High School. I'm going with three because I'm gonna be a little reserved because I have a feeling we might go a little higher. So ladies and gentlemen, I tell you, the Lanier community, the learning community is committed to academic success. We believe in winning, but we believe in winning in life. And that's something that we're just gonna do. So just watch our Vogue learning community soar. But in the meantime, here are a few highlights that conclude this school year. Last school year, we graduated 355 seniors. And as I've repeated over and over again, that was 35 more than we actually had registered. We went back and found kids that had left our school system, that had been considered dropouts, that were leavers, that had given up. And we convinced them to take a chance. And we graduated the highest graduating class in recent history. With a 27% acceptance rate to four-year universities. Currently, sir, we're at 26% and we're not done. So we're continuing to rise. Last year, 45% of our seniors applied to four-year universities. We are exactly there right now. In 2019, our senior football players received a combined four college offers totaling approximately $60,000 in scholarships. As of now, Lanier boasts a combined total of 48 college offers totaling over $700,000 in athletics and academic scholarships. Last year, we worked hard and we were able to secure 73 certifications in trade and industry. Again, we're already at 71 and the summer is even far away. So we know we're gonna break that by far. Mr. Martinez, despite our victories and successes thus far, we absolutely own that we still have a tremendous amount to accomplish before we get to our full potential. However, know that we are proud to have you as our leader, a guide and a resource, because your vision is what gives us the ability. And I'm gonna say this to the entire Lanier community. It's this vision that allows us to do what we need to do for our kids. And that's exactly the trust that we need. I will vouch to our learning community that you, sir, are with us. You are with us. So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, our current superintendent joined the San Antonio Independent School District family in 2015, bringing his laser focus on academics and ensuring that everyone believed and supported the tremendous capacities of every single one of our SAISD students. No child would left behind under Mr. Martinez. Under his leadership, our district has also earned a B rating in the state accountability ratings. And we also continue to soar with community efforts such as the recently passed largest bond package ever of $1.3 billion, all completely directed at our schools to make sure that every child has a chance at a 21st century learning opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen, señoras y señores, I proudly present our leader in chief, Superintendent Pedro Martinez.
Good evening, everyone. So I gotta tell you, I am just so excited for Lanier, and I'm so excited. I think Dr. Ortiz's energy is just very contagious. And so, you know, so first of all, thank you for being here. I know everybody's been busy. I know all of our school staff are still very busy right now. Ahead of time, we're streaming this live. And so ahead of time, we received questions, and a lot of the questions that I'm getting are, where are we with COVID? Where are we going to be with COVID next year? How are we going to start? So I want to start there and just give you a status on where we're at. So as of right now, we're just over 50% of our students that are in person. Our goal, especially parents, we want more of our students to come in person. The energy that you're seeing here at Lanier is exactly what we're seeing in our buildings. As children are coming from being remote, they're excited to be back in their classrooms. They want to be back in their classrooms. And so we just want to do it safely. So again, my main condition is we got to stay safe. We've been very fortunate here in San Antonio that our community has been safe. Cases have been low. We've been phasing children in very, very, very in a gradual way. We are one of the few districts in the country that is doing testing in every one of our schools. And when children are coming in from being remote, we invite the families to come in the week before to get tested. And the families are taking advantage of it. And that makes everybody just feel much better. The other thing is that, folks, we now have vaccinations. So as of a week ago, everyone in our district who wanted to get vaccinated is now fully vaccinated. Every single one. So that is a big deal for us, everybody. And we're not stopping there. We also now are starting to help our community members and our children get vaccinated. So one of the things that we started doing, for example, just a week ago, Friday, we started actually helping family members and students, starting with seniors, high school seniors, to get vaccinated. We got over 200 individuals vaccinated. And now we have now, in fact, we started actually having students getting vaccinated with parents' permission, and in some cases, even the parents themselves. We're going to continue that all this week. And again, we have a survey out there right now. So again, parents, I really we need your help on this. Fill out the survey if you're interested. We can get students vaccinated down to as young as age 16, always with your permission. But ladies and gentlemen, if there's one of the gifts that I want to give our seniors, I want to get them fully vaccinated by the time they finish and graduate with us, because I don't want them to worry about this as they start college, as they start working right after high school. So again, that is my number one goal. I also want to get our students their meningitis shots, because I'll tell you, meningitis shots are very expensive. They are required by all the colleges. And so if they can get them done before they graduate with us, they're free. They don't have to pay for them. So again, folks, that's where we're at with COVID right now. And then for next year, I'm getting a lot of questions about how will we start. So the goal is to end strong this year. And then for next year, for those families who want to start remote, you will have that option as long as you want it. But we'd like to have as many of our children in person. Now, one of the things that we're seeing is that vaccines could be approved for students as young as 12 years of age by next month. And so if that happens, again, working with our families, I would love to get our middle school students vaccinated. So that could mean that all of our incoming freshmen, all of our sophomores and our middle schoolers, we have a chance to get them vaccinated over the summer so that when we start the school year, they have a chance to be in person. So again, families, you know, we will do this with you. We'll always do it with your permission, but that's a great opportunity. Now for our youngest children, I don't see vaccines coming right away. Right now, the earliest that we see is maybe the end of this calendar year. It could be the beginning of next year. And so for the youngest children under 12, we probably won't have a vaccine available, but it's also going to be coming. And that is why my commitment to all of our family members, so whoever needs to start remote this next year, you will have that opportunity as long as you need to. But we know that children learning in person is the best way to go. They want to be part of the athletics. They want to be part of the fine arts. And so that's where we're at with COVID, everybody. The other question I get is, you know, why are we doing this format? And I'll tell you, there's one really big reason. So every year I do a State of the District address, and we also couple it with community meetings. But, you know, we've been in COVID. And I'll tell you, one of the things that has been one of the saddest things for me is I get to go to the buildings, and I've seen all the bond work that we're doing with our 2016 bond. I see the classrooms. I literally go into the high schools, and many times, you know, half of the high school is done, and the other high school is getting work done. And I literally stand in the middle. And I say, okay, this part is done. And I look at what it looks like. I look at the other side. This is what it looks like. And it's not done yet. And just for you to see these beautiful classrooms, to see the spaces that we're creating. And so what our goal was for this month, we wanted conditions to be safer in the community. That's why we waited till April. But we really want you to see the buildings. And so I really encourage all of you to take a tour. You know, we have all of our feeder schools represented. They have some great stations, some great information. But even more, I want you to see what we're doing here at Lanier High School. Because folks, we are giving these children the classrooms that they deserve. We're giving them the learning conditions that they deserve. So that's what I want you to see. And so our goal is to, you know, this is now my seventh community meeting. We have one more tomorrow. And then we're going to end with a overall State of the District address on the 27th at our Convocation Center. So again, that's the goal. But I hope you enjoy the information. And what I'm going to share with you today is just some statistics about where we're at as a district. We're going to see some highlights from President Rado about her region, this district, District 5. And then I hope is that, again, you get some valuable information. We'll have a chance to do some Q&A. And again, please, thank you for being here. So let me just start a little bit about myself. I've now been your superintendent for 6 years. I've been very blessed to be here in your community in this role. I was born in Mexico. I came to this country when I was turning 6. My father worked 2 jobs all of his life. I'm the oldest of 12 children. My parents had a second grade education. They just didn't have a lot of opportunity, but my father wanted to make sure that us as their children, we had better chances. And so I'm the first in my family to graduate from high school, first to go and graduate from college. And I'll tell you, the decisions I made affected my entire family. So because I went to college, every one of my siblings is either finished or finishing college. By the way, 4 teachers in the family, an oncology nurse that works with patients with the latest stages in cancer, a brother who, you know, after high school, it was right after 9/11, he said, you know, I want to join the military. I want to go into the Marines. He did two tours in Iraq, came back healthy, finished his education, and then now he has his family. So all of us were brought up to give back to the community. And so for me, when I think about what we're doing in our district, it really is giving our children the opportunities similar to myself and what my siblings had. By the way, my siblings, they all went different paths. Some of us went right into college right after high school. Some took some time. Some decided to go more into the, you know, more the career tech side. I have a brother, for example, got his GED. You know, he wasn't crazy about school. He got his GED. He now is he's a diesel mechanic. He can literally take apart a truck engine, put it back together. I can never do that. And now he actually is owning his own trucking company. So my family all took different paths. And what that tells me is, again, the job for us as a district is we got to set those pathways up for every one of our children. I have 2 children myself, one who is turning 11, another that's 7. They couldn't be more different, even though they're my 2 children. And so, and they go to 2 different schools, by the way. One, my daughter goes to Irving and a dual language program here on the West Side. And I have my son who goes to a different school because they're motivated by different things. So again, everybody, that's who I am. And what I'm going to share with you now is a little bit, again, of our data of our district. And we'll go from there. I know they're still doing some technical fixes here. Thank you, everybody. There we go. So this first slide that you're seeing, so when I, it was just in 2019 was the last year we had full testing the statewide. It was also the first time that our state commissioner came to San Antonio ISD and announced statewide results. By the way, it wasn't just him. He brought the lieutenant governor. He brought the speaker of the house. He brought the head of the education committee. Many of our reps were there. Diego Bernard, for example, was there. And so he had this whole slate of visitors. And he came to announce results at Schenck Elementary School on the south side. Why? Because Schenck had some of the biggest gains in the state. And in that, and it was a media session. And what he told the media was San Antonio ISD is a B district now, which, by the way, we knew that because we had our own projections. But what we didn't know was that in 2019, San Antonio ISD had the largest achievement gains of any district in Texas. So think about that for a second. We had the largest achievement gains of any district in Texas. And when you look at our trajectory, I started in our district in 2015. And at that time, the district was, the state was just starting to give grades. They were giving grades to school districts and then eventually the campuses. And one of the things we asked the state is, tell us what our grade would be, because we knew the standards were going to be more rigorous. And that, by the way, that's good parents, because that means that we're actually, you know, there's more rigor for our children. They're going to be better prepared coming out of high school. But we said we need to know where we're starting in this new system. You can see where our rating would have been in 2016. And this got confirmed by our accountability department. And of course, that brought a sense of urgency. And look at our trajectory, where we ended in 2019. We now match our peers in the suburbs. The other thing we learned was that back in 2016, we had about 35,000 of our children, this is out of 50,000 students, they were what we call an F schools or failing schools. And so again, this brought a sense of urgency. Look how far we brought down that number. In fact, in 2018, we had the biggest reduction in low performing schools of anybody in the state. And then we followed that up with having the highest achievement gains in the state the following year. And what's really interesting is that in 2020, when you see that number, our projections were showing that that number was going to be down another 70%. We were going to have the lowest number of low performing schools ever in our district's history. Many of our teachers were actually upset that testing got canceled because of COVID, because they wanted to show the results. So Dr. Ortiz, to your point, I have no doubt that Lanier would have been right there with your promise of having some of the highest achievement gains, because the schools were already on that path. In fact, everybody, our projection was that every high school was going to be no lower than a B, and there was going to be a tight race to see who was going to be the first A. So that's what we were seeing for 2020. That's the momentum that we built. And by the way, the thing that we saw is the gains are at scale. It is not one or two schools. It's not one neighborhood. It is across the entire district. You see this chart. We had 2 years in a row, over 60% in many cases of our schools improving, over 70% the following year. So we were building momentum, and it was at scale across our district. The other thing we saw is that graduation rates were rising. Our dropout rates were getting lower. I love the story of Lanier, the fact that they found over 30 students that already had dropped out and said, hey, come on back. We're going to help you graduate. That's where our district is now. We are literally making sure that children can succeed regardless of what their past has been, regardless of what challenges they've had. And so because of that, our dropout rate now has never been lower in our district's history. But by the way, it's not just that they're graduating better prepared. So parents, you know, and students, one of the things that really gets to me is that when children graduate and they have to take remedial classes, what does that mean? Parents, that means that our children are taking classes that don't count towards their degree, don't count towards their graduation. You have to pay for them either out of your financial aid or directly out of your pocket. I just think that's a sin. That shouldn't be happening. And so we have now closed the gap on what we call college readiness with the state. We match the state now, and we're not stopping. That means these students now are graduating better prepared. They're not having to take remedial classes. They can start their pathways immediately. And by the way, we're seeing it. We're seeing it in terms of scholarships and college acceptances. We have the highest percentage of students now attending, getting in and attending four-year universities. We have doubled the number of scholarships that our students are generating. We were generating $50 million about 5 years ago. We went over $100 million in 2020. We're already on track this year to exceed that number. And you're going to see some details about Lanier that even further really confirm what Dr. Ortiz was sharing earlier. And so one of the things, you know, I get this question a lot about, career tech. I get this question a lot. So, you know, superintendent, what about all the vocational programs? What about all those programs that help our children get into the trades, get into plumbing, electrical, et cetera? So this is the way it works now, everybody. So in our high schools, it's a relay race. We take the children with a certain certificate, and then from there, they can go to the community college or to the trades themselves and finish up, and then they can start working. So, the way I like to think about it is, think of it as a highway. So the children are on the highway, they can see it. If they wanna get off because they've gotten enough certificates and work, they can get off, right? There's a ramp. If they wanna get back on and build on it and get an associate's degree, they can get back on. If they wanna get off again and start working again, they get off. If they wanna get back on to get a bachelor's degree, they can do that. If they wanna get off and then get a master's degree, et cetera, that is what we're building across our schools. And those are the pathways that you're seeing. And by the way, we're making sure that they're the industries that are the fastest growing in San Antonio, whether it's construction, whether it's healthcare, whether it's technology. It is the fastest growing industries where children can get living wage jobs. Because I put myself as a parent in your shoes. What do we want from for our children? We want them to be good people, right? To have good hearts. We want them to be able to support themselves, to be able to have a good paying job where they can support their families. That is what we want, whatever their dreams are, right? So if they want to be a chef and they want to go into our culinary program that we have here at Lanier, which, by the way, the students graduate 30 college credits in the CIA, the Culinary Institute of America, one of the top in the country, that, there's a path for that. If they want to go into work into construction, we don't want them just to be you know, an entry-level worker. We want them to be a manager, right? So we want to build these pathways. Whatever those dreams are, that is what we're trying to do. And what I'm really proud of is that every one of our high schools now has a pathway that's that way. And I'm going to show you a video in a little while, but every one of them, and not only do they get their certificates, and I'll show you the stats on the certificates, but they can also get college credit. So look at, for example, our certificates. So back in 2017, only 17 of our students were getting certificates. Remember that I shared with you this relay race. Only 17. Look where we're at now in 2020. And by the way, we're already on track to exceed that in 2021. So these are students then that can literally take these certificates, finish up at a trade, finish up at a community college. And again, they're on that highway that I shared earlier. But what I really love, going back to this slide, every one of our high schools now has these pathways where the students can get even up to an associate's degree. So many of our high schools either have an early college program or we call the PTEC program. And I'm gonna share with you what that is in this video that talks about our PTEC programs.
A PTEC program is a school within school model. That means that a K-12 Institute of Higher Education, industry and business partners, we allow students to earn a high school diploma as well as a post-secondary credential.
There are several outcomes that we seek when we have students in a PTEC program. We want them to connect with industry all the way starting from 9th grade all the way through 12th grade and actually connect with industry partners so they get an understanding of what industry they're focusing their work in, and they are actually connected to people in the industry. So when they do graduate, they have the opportunity to create that network, those opportunities to get that work-based learning experience, to actually get a job once they graduate or continue their education.
The ideal classroom at Edison PTEC School of Business is one where students are engaged, highly engaged, in order to succeed, where you'll see a lot of project-based learning. You'll see students interacting with one another, creating ideas, learning from one another.
At the Construction Science PTEC at City Lanier High School, we actually have an emphasis within two main strands. Our construction technologies, construction science and management, you learn more about the sciences behind the construction industry. So you actually get to learn how to become a foreman and be the boss of the worksite. In the power generation and alternative energy pathway, our students will be learning different skills necessary to work on solar panels or wind turbines.
When you enter the hallways at Fox Tech High School, the first thing that you notice is that it's different than any other high school because it looks like a hospital. We teach students from day one how to conduct themselves as medical professionals.
A student should enroll in Cyber PTEC at Sam Houston High School if they're interested in information technology, computers, coding, and mostly if they're wanting to be able to join the workforce immediately in a high-wage, high-demand job.
In the PTEC program, students will spend some time here at Highlands Campus and some time at St. Philip's College getting to actually build and fix airplanes, working with electronics on our manufacturing equipment, and working with robotics and animation. It's a really hands-on program.
PTEC students are prepared to graduate from high school with a post-secondary credential. It allows career and technical pathways to occur while they are in high school, preparing them for high-wage, high-demand jobs.
Be replicated. So for example, if you say, you know, I really would love to, you know, to have that RN program that Fox Tech has. So at Fox Tech, everybody, our students will be able to get an associate's degree at the same time that they're getting the high school diploma, and then spend another 2 more years at San Antonio College for free, by the way, and finish and become a registered nurse 2 years out of high school. Think about that for a second. That's what our students are going to be able to do. So those are the programs that can be replicated, whether it's that or cybersecurity programs. Those are the programs that we're building across our high schools. And really, what the only thing we want to know is, what is it that's going to interest our children? What's going to motivate them? Because if we can, we can really tap into that, they're going to be successful, regardless of what they decide to study. So that's our goal for the career tech programs. You know, and one of the things that you've seen, our board has been very, very clear about investing in the arts. We have the largest fine art program of anybody in the region. By the way, we've won now for 3 years in a row national awards for having programs that are not only a high quality, but have accessibility across our entire district. So I'm going to show you another video that just talks about the investments in fine arts.
Parents and community members can rest assured that fine arts facilities and programs are a priority in the 2020 bond and the 2016 bond. All of our elementary students have access to a visual arts class, and all but two of our campuses have access to an elementary music program. At the secondary level, all of our academies and middle schools have access to at least two fine arts programs at each campus, and that can be theater, dance, visual art, and any of our music programs, which include mariachi, orchestra, choir, and band. And at the high school level, all of our neighborhood schools have access to at least six fine arts programs. Thanks to all of the attention and improvements that the district has invested in our fine arts programs, we've seen an immediate increase in student achievement. So there's a tremendous benefit to participation in the arts, and our community and district leadership understands that.
I'll tell you, you know, one of the things that always heartens me is when I talk to our students, especially our fine arts students that are either in band, that are in choir, any of our fine art programs, and I always say, okay, you know, these are seniors, and they've been accepted into top colleges here in San Antonio, across the state, across the country, and I said, hey, are you going to visit that campus? And they're like, you know, sir, I'm busy with band practice. Oh, I'm busy with dance. I mean, they are so committed to the arts, but I'll tell you, as Dr. Lauenbeck has said, it shows up in their achievement. And so again, we have the largest fine art programs in the region, and we're going to continue to double down on that. The other program that I'm really proud of is our dual language programs. So if you remember, you know, my background is that I came into this country turning six, didn't know how to speak English. When I came to our district, I found that we had two programs, two dual language programs, one at Bonham and one at HERF, good programs. But I noticed that when I looked at our students, that when you combine our students that were current English language learners, just like myself when I came into the district, and other students that had just, you know, exited becoming English language learners, it was about 30% of our kids. And so one of the things that, you know, and what I was watching was that many of our students were struggling. They were graduating, but barely graduating, not being as prepared. And then I did a little bit of history of South Texas. And what I saw was that really language, culture were not really encouraged here in South Texas, not just in San Antonio, but in most of South Texas. So I talked to a lot of parents. I talked to a lot of grandparents. They said, Superintendent, this was my experience growing up in San Antonio. This was my experience growing up in South Texas. So I said, you know, I got to do something different. So I found the leader, Dr. Olivia Hernandez. She was in Austin at the time. Austin, by the way, has the largest dual language program in the country, one of the largest in the country. And I said, you know, Dr. Hernandez, I really want to do something different, especially for our English language learners. And she said immediately, dual language. And she, by the way, she came to our district. She actually brought national experts all over the country, authors, researchers, talking to our parents, talking to our teachers about dual language. And I said, you know, Dr. Hernandez, I want to go kind of slow, you know, because, you know, it's a little different here in San Antonio. So I don't want to go too fast. So we can add a few campuses. I care more about quality than speed. So as she started her process engaging teachers and parents, you know, we went from two schools and there was going to be 10. I said, ooh, that sounds like a lot. But okay, if parents and teachers want to do this, then it was 20. Then it was 30. Ladies and gentlemen, this fall, we will have it in 60 of our 92 schools, dual language programs. And by the way, it is not only our English language learners, it's also our English speakers that are coming into dual language programs. And when you look at the results in the earlier grades, they're actually starting to outperform our district. So that is huge. And again, I want to thank Dr. Hernandez for being part of that. And you know, the other person I just want to call out, because We have Ms. Patty Sullivan. She's my deputy superintendent. She oversees all of the academics. And I'll tell you, the work we're doing in literacy, the work we're doing across math, she also oversees all the electives, including career tech and fine arts. But I'll tell you, under her leadership, we're building the excitement of our teachers. We have professional development with teachers where we bring in national speakers across the country. And you could see, you could feel the energy of our teachers. And Deputy Superintendent Salzman, thank you for your leadership because you are creating that. By the way, when it comes to our teachers, and I don't have slides on this, but I'll tell you, our turnover has never been lower. Our teacher satisfaction has never been higher. And even though right now there's a lot of stress because of COVID, I mean, people are very tired, but I'll tell you, in terms of the morale, it has never been stronger. And again, it is our teachers that are doing God's work along with our paraprofessionals that are really supporting your children. And so what I want to finish with is, you know, really our response during COVID. You know, COVID has been a worldwide phenomenon. It really has challenged all of us. And I want to thank our community for always sticking with us and being part, you know, really helping us through this. And I feel like we're starting to get to the other end of it. But I want you to just see a couple of videos of just, you know, how it's propelled and accelerated our technology efforts, as well as even what, you know, I was so proud of our transportation staff and our food service staff of how they responded, how they wanted to be part of the solution with the community. So I just want to play these videos for you.
Within the last 6-8 months, our district is truly a one-to-one district, both with Chromebooks and iPads. Now every student has their own dedicated device for learning. Another term that you hear in San Antonio is flagship classrooms. What those are model classrooms. They will be equipped with all the technology tools from the infrastructure, the laptop carts, the smart boards, all of the tools necessary for our future vision. Part of the technology strategy was learning everywhere. When they get on the bus in the morning, we wanted connectivity. When they get to school, we wanted connectivity anywhere on their campus. And the last piece of that puzzle was connectivity at home. So as a result of a partnership with the city of San Antonio, at the cost of $27 million, we have now started deploying access, internet access, to our students' homes.
So we've got the coolest buses. All of them have Wi-Fi, so students can access tons of electronic books through the bibliotheque website that they can get on one of our buses. Our buses have GPS. They have a student badge program. All of our buses have both interior and exterior cameras. All of our route buses have AC. And then our new school buses have automatic anti-brake control and anti-skid control. Right now, about 40% of our school buses are propane. It emits fewer toxins. So our students who have asthma or breathing problems, it totally eliminates those for our students. So when the pandemic started, there was a concern about making sure that our students and our parents got food during this trying time. And so I know we called our drivers and all of them wanted to come in and help. We almost had about 100 school buses delivering meals. Each bus would deliver about 250 meals a day. And then we also delivered books as well, which was neat, and technology items as well too.
So now I'm gonna ask Ms. Rado to come up and give really some facts about the region and the district. But you know, the one thing I'll say about Ms. Rado, her integrity, her approach to really serving this community always inspires me. One of the things that I love about Ms. Rado is that not only is she humble, but I'll tell you, she's always asking me, how do we better serve the West Side? Not only in education, but how do we also be an advocate for housing? How do we become an advocate for families just having better jobs? And so that is who Ms. Rado is. And I know, even though she wasn't born on the West Side, being here over 5 decades here on the West Side just says a lot about her. Thank you, Ms. Rado, for being our true leader on the board. Ms. Rado, please.
Well, thank you. It's truly a joy to be able to be here in person with you. So many people that we've only seen through a little box screen on a computer for so long. So it's wonderful to be with you. I'd like to ask you to give a big hand for our super passionate and enthusiastic, wonderful principal of Lanier, Dr. Ortiz. Dr. Ortiz, thank you so much for your wonderful leadership here and the wonderful leadership we have throughout District 5 with wonderful principals that are here. Thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you for everything you do. And I know it's been such a challenging 14 months now that we've been together through the pandemic. And we're so, so grateful to all our teachers throughout the entire district. And I'm very mindful of what it's like trying to balance family and this, the basic challenges of the pandemic and the children that for months you had at home with you while you're trying to teach the children on the screen. Thank you so much for your patience and really being a team of togetherness as we all struggle through the challenge of this pandemic. So thank you so, so very, very much. So, right away I started going too fast. Okay, so right here is a chart of all the schools that are in District 5. And we have 17 schools in District 5. We've got two traditional middle schools and of course Lanier High School, 9 elementary schools and academies and 3 alternative campuses. And 2 of our campuses are some of the dual language schools that we learned about. And now we have Rodriguez Montessori. We opened a Montessori school, the first public Montessori school in a public school in San Antonio a couple of years ago. And I thought, man, I want one of those on the west side. And sure enough, we got one over at Rodriguez. A wonderful curriculum, wonderful opportunity for our students. Lanier, looking at academic highlights, Lanier increased so much. So many of the things we'll be talking about in academics are from like the school year of 2018 all the way up to the present. And Lanier increased overall in its rating very dramatically, going up 18 points in achievement and 14 points in academics. So tremendous, tremendous. And then we have and we were headed towards a B rating, right? Irving, under the direction of Olivia Almanza Pena, became an A district. So great congratulations there. And other academic highlights we have under the leadership of Rick Flores over at Rhodes, they increased their overall score and earned a distinction in social studies. With Jeff Price over at Tafoya, we improved 10 points overall and saw double digit gains in academic growth, up 13 points, folks. Under Jackie Ibarra Langford over at Barclay Ruiz, we made gains in all domains and earned distinction in science, academic growth, and closing the gap. With Donna Finch at Dezavala, thank you, yes, give Jackie a big hand. And at Dezavala with Donna Finch, we moved out of improvement required. What does that mean? It's like the word we don't like to say, right? That begins with an F, but she went up to a C in 1 year. That's a lot of moving. That's a lot of moving. Donna, thank you to you and your team so very, very much. Most of our District 5 schools saw significant gains in 2019, and we're on track to continue this upward trajectory in 2020. Here we see the various programs. We've talked about some of them, about the PTEC and the dual language and our choice schools. It's pretty small and light to be able to read those, but again, in District 5, this the first column, look at how many dual language schools we have just in District 5. Do you know that in District 5, we have 17 campuses? That's like about 18% of all the schools in SAISD. So When my husband makes cookies and brings them to your campus, that's a lot of cookies. So, and again, we mentioned about the P-TECH programs, marvelous programs, and Lanier High School has the construction science P-TECH. So lots of opportunities in the schools right here in District 5. Continuing with early childhood options, look at how many pre-K programs we have and Head Start programs. Again, District 5 is a home to a wide variety of high quality programs for 3- and 4-year-olds. And we have Head Start at 4 campuses and pre-K at 11 of the schools, including the Montessori school and an all dual language school at Irving. The added extra thing at the Montessori school is it's Montessori, but also you can choose a dual language pathway. Yeah. Our scholars, and we have some outstanding scholars with us tonight, but look at this, our scholars who are bound for college. Some of you recognize the icons, but let me tell you first that so far, our students have won 3,409,000 in scholarships. Up here, if you don't recognize it, we've got Kentucky, New York, Colorado, Chicago, Arizona, Pennsylvania, and then a slew of colleges and universities in Texas. So our students are moving on to great places. Now, I understand our students that we're recognizing are here tonight. So I'd first like to ask, and again, we use these wonderful students as examples of so many tremendous students we have here at Lanier. But Elizabeth Gutierrez, are you here? She is here. And are your parents here? Well, Elizabeth Gutierrez has quite a story. She is a well-rounded student. She is an academic member of the Mexican-American Unity Council, student council, she's on student council where she serves as a historian, National Honor Society, where she serves as the vice president, the Spanish National Honor Society, and the Architect Construction and Engineering Mentor Program, the ACE program at Lanier. Above that, she has participated in varsity tennis and track from 9th grade to 11th grade. She has won first and second place in 2 different tournaments for mixed doubles. She is one of the few students who have decided to apply out of state, receiving acceptance letters from several universities with amazing interior design programs. Her older sister, Katrina Gutierrez, you may remember, was the 2019 Lanier Volk valedictorian who attends Smith College now. So her family values education and helps emphasize high aspirations. Elizabeth, we are extremely proud of you. Another hand for Elizabeth. Tremendous. And how about Damian and Fabian Chavez? Are you here? All right, very good. And your parents? Are your parents here? Where are the parents? There you are. All right. Woo-hoo. All right. Well, Damian and Fabian, they are twin brothers who motivate each other to excel. Both made all region and all area band. Both have applied to several universities, but both place St. Mary's University as their top choice to pursue music. They are both extremely respectful, hardworking young men with supportive parents, and we expect nothing short of excellence as they pursue their college degrees. Damian is the current valedictorian for the class of 2021. And Fabian is a salutatorian. Education is a high value in that household. And that brings me to say thank you to parents who know how important the education system is. Know that it's a ticket to many more places than what you may have grown up dreaming of. So thank you again, parents, for your tremendous support. Also, we want to make mention that Fabian is the first student to make the all-state band from Lanier since 1988. So. Now we want to go on to talk about the flagship classrooms. Six classrooms in our district have been selected across the district as model classrooms for Bond 2020, including District 5's own Irving Dual Language School. So let's watch a video here that will demonstrate to you the opportunities we have in a flagship classroom. Go. Also, we have classrooms we call Lighthouse 2.0. Lighthouse campuses are model classrooms for technology and include features such as the whiteboards, like you saw in this video, upgraded infrastructure, and all the tools our students and teachers need for learning. They preview what all the classrooms will look like as a result of the bond. District 5 is home to five Lighthouse campuses, including Barclay Reese and De Zavala, Mar Hill, and Crockett. But soon all our classrooms will have all of these benefits. And that brings us to the important issue that parents, voters, any of you are responsible for. We brought forth boldly the opportunities of these bonds in 2016 and for 2020 with, again, that famous $1.3 billion bond that you voted for, you passed, you said yes to the future of our students. And as a result of the 2016 bond, Lanier has seen significant renovations, which you will be able to see here in person tonight. So we hope you will, you know, travel around through the building. You can see very obviously that Lanier is not finished, right? We got about another year to go. But what you will see is a tremendous difference. You can also see the virtual tour that we will have here at the end of our program and here in the gym. Everything from major systems like heating and air conditioning, plumbing and electrical, have been redone, and our facilities have never been better. You will see new classroom spaces as well as new cafeteria, auditorium, and more. Lanier is also now equipped with special needs accessibility to serve our families, staff, and visitors. So these are some of the slides that shows some of the extraordinary changes here at Lanier. And Lanier is one of the schools that have had major renovations, but also is Tafoya. So how many people have been inside Tafoya and seen the changes? All right, well, when you go, you will be amazed. Just the redness is a fun thing, right? It just kind of lights you up as you go in there. So you can see, certainly from the outside, y'all have witnessed how the facade has changed and the shading, but the halls look magnificent. And when you tour today, you'll see the kind of desks in person that are being used to various schools throughout the district. It might look kind of weird shaped, but it allows us to put desks in circles or next to one another or make a long table. So it offers us quite a variety. And then let's take a look at Irving. Look at that international wall there. Isn't that beautiful with all the different flags? But most of our schools will be getting like new entryways. With the bond, with the 2016 and the 2020 bond, all our schools have been touched in some way. And it might be electrical, it might be heating, it might be safety, it might be the entryway, but all schools are being touched by these bonds. And here we are, JT Brackenridge. Again, everybody's been going in the back for years, right? Well, now it's emphasized. Now you really know where to go in. So the 2020 bond, again, we have to thank you for the magnificent difference that you are making for our children. You've seen Lanier going under a major, major renovation. In the 2020 bond, you're going to see other major renovations in District 5, in particular for Rhodes Middle School, going to be big, as well as Storm Elementary and Carvajal. Storm is one of those where I say, oh my goodness, you know, when you go into that building, you've got to pass by the trash cans and everything. And it's like, well, is this really the entrance? Hopefully through the 2020 bond, you're going to know where to get into that school, and it's going to be beautiful. So again, we can't thank you enough. There's going to be $164 million spent in District 5 for these renovations. And five other campuses that will have new air conditioner chillers include Crockett, De Zavala, Marhill, Estrada, and Cooper at Novato. So a lot of things coming. Thank you, thank you, thank you for what you have done to support the changes in the district. And at this time, we're going to have questions and answers. And so I invite Mr. Martinez to come up again. Thank you for your attention, and thank you for all you have done.
Thank you, Ms. Rado. So at this time, again, we'll be happy to take any questions. And Ms. Rado and I are going to be here. So again, if you want to just come up and also ask us questions, we'll be here as well afterwards. But I really encourage everybody to take a look, do a tour, take a look at the building, look at the classrooms. They're beautiful. This is really our opening, our wonderful Lanier High School to the community, so you can see what's been going on with so many of our children that started remote, have been remote. So this is really your chance to see that. But again, be happy to take any questions. I don't see any, but like I said, Ms. Rado and I, we're going to be here in case you want to come up and just ask us questions. Everybody, thank you for being here. Thank you for taking the time. Take advantage. Take a look at the classroom. See what's coming to your schools. Thank you, everyone. Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
For those of you that are here, if you would like to stay just a couple of more minutes, there's something that's very impacting that we're about to show you, and it's a virtual tour of Lanier, once it's designed, narrated by our trustee, Ms. Radel. This will take a couple of seconds, but it's going to be very eye-opening for you, and I hope you can take advantage.
Welcome to Sydney Lanier High School, home of the Mighty Vokes. I'm Patty Radel, and I'm a member of the San Antonio Independent School District Board of Trustees, and I represent District 5. We want to show you around Lanier and present a lot of wonderful things that Lanier has to offer, so come on in. Right from the start, you'll notice the beauty of this campus because of the bond work from our 2016 bond program. It has totally changed the face, quite literally, of Lanier High School. The beautiful new arches and architecture highlight the historic building, and it makes us proud to continue the rich legacy of Lanier High School. Students also will enjoy wide hallways, a new main mall, cafeteria and kitchen, as well as renovated classrooms. One new feature of Lanier is the learning stair, which is being adopted throughout the district by other SAISD high schools. The unique nature of this stair is that it allows for student collaboration, college style lectures, and other learning activities. Lanier also features a college ready go center, allowing students to apply for scholarships, research their dream schools, plan big for life after graduation, and discuss their strategy with their counselors. Lanier features advanced placement, a construction science PTech, architecture design, automotive technology, business information management, cosmetology, culinary arts, engineering design, health science, computer science, and programming, law enforcement, marketing and entrepreneurship, world languages and printing and imaging with its own printing facility. Among our extracurricular offerings, we have art, band, choir, mariachi, music, orchestra, theater, aquatics, ready for some more, basketball, cross country, football, golf, soccer, academic decathlon, yearbook, and more. The wood shop is impressive, and it's a place where students get to build. Their creativity comes to life with careful supervision from their teachers. Our library is off to the west end of the main campus and is spacious for learning opportunities and for research projects. The athletic and fine arts facilities are perfect for students to begin or continue their passion in music and sports. We are excited for you to join Voke Nation. Here at Lanier High School, we care about every student, and we are interested in individualizing your experience here at Lanier so that you can discover what your interests truly are. And as a district, we want to produce and promote students who are really ready for the real world.
In conclusion to tonight's event, I just want to invite everyone to tour our campus. Right now, our cafeteria areas that all of our athletic programs have set up displays. Our atrium is open with all of our special programs and our clubs and organizations. All the classrooms upstairs and downstairs are open for you to view. Our CT foyer is hosting all of our business partners in our CTE program, and every single one of our CTE classrooms is open and teachers are on standby to answer questions regarding programming. So if you're a parent of an eighth grader that's incoming, or you're a current eighth grader that never got a visit last year or has been on our campus, everyone is here to serve you and answer your questions. So thank you for coming. We hope you can stay a bit. And for the record, our culinary students are selling packaged to-go dinners, parents, in case you don't want to cook when you get home. So we're bringing it all to you. Thank you for coming. Go Vokes, go.